It's the Forensic Lunch! And while I do feel good that we've managed for the second time to actually attach to the right stream and the pre-scheduled stream of YouTube, I'm still wondering whether or not I got the timing right on that announcement. Now that I feel a whole lot better about how things actually work in the delay in the stream and everything else. So I know that a lot of you guys are watching right now. I can see the viewer count going up. So let me know what the stream started with. Did it start with me staring at the screen for a little too long in silence? Or did it start with me saying it's the Forensic Lunch right away? I'm still working out that timing. But otherwise, happy, whoa, I just hit the microphone. Happy 2020, everybody. It's a new year. New year for the podcast, aka the videocast, aka the live broadcast, aka anything else we manage to do with it. We have a lot to talk about today. Very glad that you're here again. Forensic Lunch right away. Yes, that's right. we have a lot to talk about. A lot of good things going on this year. A lot of good things that we're planning to do. And so we're going to talk all about all sorts of stuff. And our guest this week is Mr. Lee Whitfield. And so first, of course, as always, I always start by saying hello to our good friend Matthew. Hello, Matthew.
Well, hello. It's a new year for beards.
It is a new year for beards. Now, Matthew, for those who haven't been following your Twitter stream, you have been posting some very interesting monitoring tools in Rust.
Yeah. So, a little bit earlier this year, I had started working on an ETL monitor in Python, and then during the summer, I had a little bit of a break and wanted to learn more Rust. I had started that a couple years ago, but didn't really get it down. Kind of got close, made some cool tools, but nothing great. And then Ben Amran, who's been making these awesome libraries in Rust, he has an MFT, a event log tool. He kind of helped me take it to the next step, showed me a lot of really cool things. So I was like, all right, I really just want to switch over to Rust at this point. The main thing holding me back from going to Rust was the lack of like any type of volume access, image access, like we love with DFVFS for so long. I'm just getting over that. Don't have it, probably won't have it for a very long time, but that's okay. Anyways, so I had started off with a USN monitor, which is really cool. It really shows you what actions you perform and how that looks and what you're going to see in the USN artifact. The next thing I did was a event log monitor. Windows API has some really good functions for being able to monitor a lot of these things. So it's really cool to be able to see what you're doing in real time in the event log. So if I wanted to, run an application or some type of exploit, or I don't know, you can just see what gets generated in the event logs as it happens in real time. Nothing new there, though. I mean, you could run Windows Event Beats or something, pipe it into Elastic, be looking at Elastic, and see the events in near real time as well, but it's not exactly like 100% real time. You don't, it's kind of cooler when you get to see it like this. The events just flash up in front of you, then you're like, whoa, I didn't even know there was an event that had this type of information in it. So, and that's kind of the goal with these monitors too, is I want them to be research utilities that really allow you to see, okay, when I perform these actions, what gets generated in these event logs. Well, so then I had started, I want to start moving over all my Python ETL monitoring stuff into Rust. But that's a really large undertaking because it's a very complex API system. And all of this stuff is, Rust already is a lower level than I'm used to. But mix that on top of interacting on a low level C with the Windows API makes things a little hard. But I'm getting the hang of it. I'm starting to be able to pop stuff out, which is nice. So the reason I wanted to do the ETL stuff is not necessarily to listen to ETL in real time itself, but because it acts as a triggering system to monitor other forensic artifacts. So one of the most recent thing that I did was I created a MFT monitor. Well, I don't, it's not really a monitor because you have to, hit the enter button to see, to get basically a snapshot of a specific MFT entry. Hit enter again, then it's going to show you just the differences and attributes that changed. Which is really cool because we've seen in the past how there's all sorts of different things that we don't really know about the MFT or don't understand about it. One of the best examples I like is when, we showed a long time ago how if you created a file using an alternate NTFS driver, how that affects different attributes in the MFT. Because not a lot of the MFT internals are out there, right? So different drivers might implement different, binary fields differently. So when you start using other drivers, you can kind of see the differences of, hey, this is something specific to Microsoft and how it uses the MFT versus this NTFS 3G driver does some different things with these unknown fields that aren't marked very well in any type of MFT documentation. So it's a cool way to just really get down deep into what actions affect an artifact in what ways down to the low level. The ETL stuff, I kind of put a break on because it was going to be easier to do the MFT thing like that. My next thing that I want to do is I want to start moving over some of my USN monitor stuff into the same package that I'm using for all of these monitors. Because what that's going to allow me to do is something like monitoring the MFT in real time, because the USN monitoring, shows you what MFT entries are getting created, which ones are getting deleted. So instead of sitting there and having to hit enter in between each time you make a change and maybe something else affecting that change, now I'll just be able to stream the very specific attributes that are changing on a given MFT entry in real time. Which will give you a lot better sense of, okay, if I do this action, what attribute changes? The great thing about that is you can use, some log file parsing tools, and you'll actually see all of those changes in the NTFS log file. There's quite a few log file tools out there now. But that's just one other thing that can say, okay, well, if I saw this, activity in a log file, what could it mean? Well, it's basically just the transactions of MFT entry updates. So now, by better understanding how your action affects individual MFT entries, you're able to kind of apply that to what you see historically from the log file. Then things like the ETL, one day once I get that going, that just allows me to also create trigger points. Like I could create trigger points. If I started an application up and wanted to just monitor all of the MFT entry changes that a specific application does, ETL would allow me to do that because ETL is going to tell me in real time what files are being created by what processes, whereas the USN is only telling me what files are created or deleted or changed. ETL can give me that information, but on a per process basis. So it'd be kind of cool to be able to launch something and just track the MFT entry changes, but only get the difference of attribute values that are changing while an application is running. So to do stuff like that is kind of cool. So that's what I'm wanting to accomplish one day when I get the ETL stuff merged over. All of these monitor type things are just great ways to create trigger points. So that you can look more in depth at the individual artifacts. Because it's not like Windows API is going to have any type of functionality to, monitor a prefetch file, right? But you can monitor something that tells you when the prefetch file changes and then use a low-level library to grab the binary structures out of it, do comparisons, and then now you can understand, better the inner workings of, the prefetch format or any other format that you want to do this to, right? Like you could monitor your link files in real time or say, okay, how can I create a link file that has these specific attributes or looks like this? Well, then I can just create, keep performing actions until I see that type of structure being created, then I can correlate that structure being created with my action, right? The what kind of started this was a while back when you did that. It was a user assist, your Sunday fun days, which you should bring those back. Those were fun.
So I have a new blog template, and I was working with a guy, and then I kind of went silent on him because I got too busy, and so I need to get back with him so he can attach the new template, and then I'll start blogging again. So that is going to happen. That is a 2020 thing.
Yeah, those Sunday fun days always produced a lot of cool stuff. So you had done, it was a how do you run an application without updating the execution count? And the way I went about figuring that out was, all right, I'm going to monitor the registry. Windows API does give you some registry monitoring abilities, but it's even better using the ETL stuff. But at the time, I didn't have any of that done. So I use just the regular registry APIs to monitor registry changes for the user assist. That, of course, gives you some binary structures that you have to parse out. So then I could do some differences. Then, basically, after that, I could just, you know, perform different actions and figure out what action was it going to be that ran the tool but didn't update its execution count. And of course, we figured that, you know, you could create a task to kick off. Basically, it was anything that the user doesn't use interactively to launch the tool itself, I think was what we found out of that.
Yeah, that's correct. So anything from a run key, anything from a start key, anything that was launched outside of the user, actually directly launching it from a GUI.
Right. But yeah, so that was my methodology on going about, okay, we know occasionally we see this pattern in forensic artifacts, but what causes that to happen? And is there a way that I can, you know, monitor an artifact, perform actions, and then see how my actions affect that artifact to help me figure out what actions are occurring when I see what type of patterns within artifacts, right? Anyways, so what I would like to do over the next year is, you know, have that as kind of my reference point for any type of talking or presentations that I do, is be able to show these tools and be like, all right, here's what happens when we run this, and this is what it generates, and what does this mean, and how can we use tools like this to help us dig deeper into what our artifacts are showing us and what do they mean. And when we don't understand what they mean, can we produce any type of actions that match up to what we're seeing? So that's the goal.
Yeah, and you know, I've used some of the math monitors before when we did the test kitchens. You know, I'd be showing events as they happen in real time. And I think, you know, one of the big benefits of doing, let's say, event log monitor. One of the big reasons that you want to do an event log monitor instead of actually ingesting the event logs as they're created is that this way you can actually subscribe to certain channels. And within the event log API, a channel is a log source. So you can actually say, I only want to know when new entries are created as they're created inside of this specific event log or subscribing to this particular event. And that way, as you're doing things, you don't have to have the rest of the noise. And this is one of the things you're going to find out. If you're doing forensics testing, validation, or research, being able to strip out the noise happening in the background away from your own testing and actions is probably one of the harder things to do, to be able to actually view what effect your actions are taking on the system that you're analyzing. In fact, that was one of the biggest hurdles when Matt and I were doing the Triforce testing. Initially, was trying to figure out, well, what is all this extra stuff? What is it? And that's when we finally say, wait a second, we're doing all this testing on the system volume. We need to make a secondary volume that the system shouldn't be touching. And that way, we can actually have a much lower background set of noise so we can actually find our actions. So I think on the event log side, that's probably the most useful. The other is that you can turn on and off event logs through the API without having to go through and change the configuration of the system each time. So as you're doing your testing, you can kind of select these things on and off to kind of turn them on and off and see what happens as you do different things. On the ETL side, and this is something we've talked about ETLs a lot, and you know, Nicole's presented tools on parsing the deadbox ETLs. Matt's talked about ETLs and the ETL monitoring. The big thing I want you to think about when you think about ETLs, and I really hate when people say, think this, or think that, or this is like this. I don't know, I think people, it's a bit of overused, I try not to say it. So let me try putting that a different way. The way that I compare an ETL monitor to something like a antivirus anti-malware kit that is actually doing some type of hooking is that when you're doing any type of ETL stuff, you don't have to introduce anything, A, not native into the environment, and B, you're capturing the calls as they're being created, and you can subscribe to the process, like for instance the kernel or the file system driver, so you can actually see the changes as they're occurring without introducing anything artificial or worrying about breaking anything. So it's good for testing, and I think you're going to see a lot more of the possibly the product size and people adopting it. And it looks like Matt has a demo. I love demos. Let's see this.
Yeah, I'll just throw something up real quick. So this is the what I call the MFT listener. And what it allows you to do is I just want to listen to this test file that I created. So I'm going to hit it. And this is cool. So it's really fun because this is a lot of use between Windows API usage and binary parsers. So it's using Binamran's MFT library to parse all this data out, but it's using the Windows API to figure out, okay, I just gave it a file name. How do I get the inode from the file name that I just passed it? And what do I need to do with the Windows API to be able to collect that type of background information just to find the MFT entry? And how am I reading the MFT entry from the volume? That's the cool part. There's API functions that allow you to read raw MFT entries from the volume without having to parse out a file hand or use some type of translation layer on the volume to be able to figure out where the MFT exists and then from the MFT read it, get the right entry. Anyways, it's really cool. The more I dive into the Windows API stuff, the cooler this gets. So when I initially launched this, I point it to a file. It's going to just kind of dump out the MFT entry for me. But as I might make changes to this file, let me go make a change real quick, and then we're going to do a difference. All right, so I just made a change to that file. I'm going to hit enter, and that gives you all of the attributes that just changed between what it was originally and then what I just did to it and what that looks like in the MFT. So, from this, can you figure out what I just did to that file? Right here, we look at our one of our standard information attributes, and we see before we just had this one flag. After I made a change, hit enter. Now we have two flags here. So we know that now it has a read-only flag. We see the access date update. We see a modified time update. We see the USN number update. This is the reference to the last change in the USN journal. And then we see the transactional journal change. This is the last change in the NTFS log file. So if you went to this LSN number in the log file, you would actually see the very MFT entry, the difference that just occurred. So that's kind of cool. And then same thing in the log file or in the USN journal, I mean. So if you went to this USN number within the USN journal, it would represent the change that just occurred. Right? So open it up. We'll just add some data to it. Well, that might not work. Don't you love it when things don't work? I don't think it wants to work because, well, I don't know. Why isn't it working? Hold on.
What did you do, Matthew? Oh, it's me.
Oh, I'm so silly. It's in read-only. I was like
Was gonna
opening it
say,
up
you
in a
weren't
text
read-only.
editor. Hey, sometimes you do stuff live and this is what live is all about, right? All right, so I just added some stuff to it, some data. We can see what changed. We have another metadata transaction journal. That's the NTFS log file. USN journal changed, probably saying that there's been some.└››                                                                                                                                       └└================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================ basic information changes. Header used, so this was an empty file. This is kind of cool. This was an empty file. We see a first attribute ID just went up. That means an attribute's been created. The question is, oh, and here's our attribute creation. So it actually removed a data attribute and it created a new one. So it removed the data attribute with ID 1 and created a new data attribute with ID 5, and this is the data that it put into that attribute. Kind of cool, right? Mm-hmm. So then you get your other stuff before, after. But this is when it gets cool, is seeing what changes, you know, how they affect the removal of attributes, the creation of new attributes. Some of them will just only change the attributes, right? So if you see something gets removed, it's just going to show that attribute dot the name of the attribute dot the attribute ID. So that's kind of its the attribute's unique identifier. It'll tell you that, hey, this one got removed, but a new attribute with ID 5 got created. Here's what that looks like. So anyways, no, that's all I got.
That's all I got. Just something cool and nifty and new. I mean, when you're thinking about this, one of the reasons that I use tools like this is that it's reading from the raw NTFS partition, which means that I don't have to worry about the actions that I'm taking afterwards to check the data to affect the data. In other words, I'm not doing something that's going to create an access, it's going to create a metadata change or something else like that, because I'm checking the properties of the files. And I don't have to wait, if I'm looking at this, let's say through a forensics tool, I don't have to refresh my view of the disk each time to go and look at the data or re-pull the inode. I can just hit enter and see it as I go. And because Matthew has tied this to a specific file rather than the whole disk, it means, again, we can target that to a specific file, perform actions, and we can validate what's going on, what we're doing. It's, I mean, if you are doing any type of testing validation research, that is incredibly helpful all the way across.
Yeah, and see, like, once I can get that USN functionality built in, it's going to be so much better, because you're not going to have to keep hitting enter, right? It's just, it's going to show you the changes in real time, which is awesome. It doesn't need to be interactive with the user. So, and then, yeah, like I said, then once the ETL stuff gets done, you're going to be able to have a lot more control over when you want to trigger these differences. If I just want, I only want to see the changes that a specific application is making. All right, all I have to do is filter on the process ID that generated an ETL event, and there you go. Or if I want to monitor not the MFT, I want to do, you know, like I said, the link files or the jump list. You know, you have to have some type of trigger that tells you when it gets updated. If you wanted to get super crazy with it, the ETL stuff even shows you the file offsets that get changed on, you know, when it updates a file. I don't think I would use that. That's getting a little too crazy. But if you wanted to get that crazy, you could.
No, I mean, because I think something like that, Matthew, would... There is a... I wouldn't call them forensic conspiracy theories, because that's probably the wrong word. There is a competing series of hypotheses between Matthew and I about a particular offset within the prefetch and what it means.
Yeah.
And so I think something like that would be incredibly helpful. It's because then we could be like, when I loaded this function from this library, this actually changed, and I can actually see the difference.
Right?
Right? Yeah.
Well, and it was like a while back, we also saw, you know, there's MFT entry numbers in the prefetches.
Yep.
But it was weird because it was like on a per, like almost per DLL level, but it wasn't. It's like some DL, there was basically two arrays. There was in a DLL array, right? And then your entry array. It's like, I still don't know what those entries are. I think some of those entries reference the DLLs, but then there's a whole lot missing too. So I'd still like to know more about those MFT entries that are in the prefetch.
Yeah, and there's some other mysteries too. Ladrina says, me doing host-based research takes forever. My colleague, more experienced with detections. Tell me when you're ready to test. We'll walk it through with ETL. And so the tricky thing there, Ladrina, and I wish I could say this was going to be a silver bullet for everything, is that you actually have to know then the event source that you should be subscribing to.
And yeah, that's hard.
Not as easy as it sounds. So I would say on the event log side, it's much more defined and easy, but if you've heard us talk about ETLs at all, you would know that every application and every system driver basically can create an ETL that's callable, that you can subscribe to for changes. I mean, probably for host-based stuff, you'll be looking at the file system driver, looking at the maybe at the kernel, AOE depending upon what you're trying to get. But that's going to require some knowledge documentation to help people understand that.
Yeah, and I mean, like, these type of monitors help you figure that type of stuff out.
Yep.
It's like there's an ETL channel for the NTFS log file. So whenever the log file basically gets committed, you see that in the ETL, which is cool. Then other things, but then you would think, like, I would love, originally I was like, okay, I could monitor the MFT via the ETL because the ETL should show you when a specific entry gets written, but they don't. And I think we had talked about that a long time ago, and actually Vico was like, oh, it's probably because it's memory mapped mm-hmm. that you're not going to see that. But you do see MFT reads in the ETL.
Yep.
You just don't see the writes. So that's kind of strange, right? Yeah, so, and I think the last time I ran it, there's like thousands of providers.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Knowing what data you want where is really hard. And it comes down to, okay, I need a tool. I need something that's going to be able to show what type of information is in that data. And a lot of times, oh, I can't tell you how many times I was like, oh, yes, I know how I could monitor this artifact or something. There's a prefetch provider. It's like, okay, that's got to be cool. Listen to it.
Nope.
Nothing. Absolutely nothing.
It was like, not.
That really got my hopes up. But there's so many providers that I'm like, oh, I bet you there's going to be some crazy information in this. Monitor. Nothing. Well, I tried.
Yeah, so. And I would say that's probably the one limitation of ETLs is that there is no consistent universal requirement for what they have to export. So it's whatever the developer who created the ETL stream wanted to expose for their testing. And that's the biggest difference between ETLs and ETWs. So ETWs are event log sources. Here's my hand. Hold on. And then over here is ETLs, and these are application sources. So event log sources are basically created for the whole system and meant to be documented and reviewed. And ETL sources are by application, are really meant for debugging and testing on a per application basis. Eric just came and asked if you can start over.
We'll have another forensic lunch in a couple of weeks, and I'm sure I'll need something to talk about.
So. Aren't you glad, Eric, this is recorded?
Replay. I mean,
you can start over anytime. and of course, all of this will come out in the test kitchen. Now, for those wondering, Dave, what happened to the test kitchen? Well, to my left, if I make a sound real loud, is the machine that I do the test kitchens on, which is currently unplugged and has been for the last... Since I've moved, honestly, and I have these new monitors in front of me that I'm looking at that I just need to hook it up, to be honest. I just need to hook it up, and I need to get it all going. I finally found the moving box with the keyboard and mouse in it, so I think I'll be able to get that going. But yeah, I need to get that going, and then we can play with Matt's tools, and Matt will come on, and we'll start testing some more stuff and checking some more stuff out. Things that I need to test, I know, are the BAM, DAM keys, and then there are some very funky things happening in the Windows 10 timeline.
See, and once I get the ETL stuff going, we can live monitor the registry, and we can just watch those keys change in real time.
I mean, I'll be honest, the user assist registry monitor is, to me, some really cool stuff. I mean, when I can just sit there and, like, do things and bling, 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 it's just like, it's doing something.
And it always surprises you, too, because you're like, oh, why didn't this show up? I thought this would have shown up.
Yep.
Huh, must be a different trigger or something. I don't know.
And I would say that is probably the most frustrating thing, because you're used to, if you're doing analysis, you're used to seeing the final resting point of all this data. You're used to seeing what it looks like for you to go analyze and when it's there. And then you find out that creating that thing that you already saw existing is harder than you think. Sometimes it's exactly what you think, and other times it's like, oh, I had to do this other thing first, and I didn't realize that, and that changes how I think about this thing.
Yeah, so if you want those tools, they're on my GitHubs. They're kind of spread out. The USN monitors and the Rusty USN package, all the other ones are in the RS Windows thingies. I plan to clean up a lot of stuff, but kid's about to come. I don't know how much time I'm going to have. I'm sure I will rig them up to make them look pretty for any talks that I do. But I'm not going to tell you it's going to be easy to just go download them, compile them. Most of them, actually, I think all of them now are being compiled. So you can just grab the binary. You don't have to worry about compiling any Rust. By the way, even the event log, I think the when the event log monitor is running, it's like less than a megabyte in memory. Same with the MFT, like the binary sizes are just barely a megabyte, if not a little over. I love Rust. It was a challenge to get to figure it all out, but now that I'm there, and I'm not even close to, you know, being a Rust guru at all, but I can at least, you know, do things that I want to do and realize that how much faster and less resource intensive it is. So that's cool.
Yeah, and so for those who didn't pick up the clue there, Matthew is soon to be a beer dad and have a baby beard, which means that Matthew's concepts of time are about to change. And so, for those of you who were making future plans on building some type of massive a tooling upon all of this for your for the world's benefit, you might want to make sure that whatever you need done gets done. How many weeks, Matthew?
I've got 5 weeks left, I think.
5 weeks?
6 weeks. No, 6 weeks. Yeah, 6 weeks
You have
left.
6 weeks to make sure that if there's something you wanted Matthew to do, it's done before baby comes.
Yeah, Eric over there, you're welcome, even though I abandoned you. Thanks, buddy. It made me a better person. So.
Rust made me a better person.
But that's okay. I understand. I saw your comment today on Ben Amran's thing too. That was funny.
All right.
But yeah, .NET is coming. .NET Core, and then everyone can use Eric's stuff on Linux too. Cool. Well, we should jump over to Lee at
We
some
should
point.
change over to Lee. It's been over 30 minutes, and but hey, we've had hopefully interesting things to talk about. Lee Whitfield, it's been a long time.
It has. And first, let me offer my condolences to Matt, as it so seems as if someone's stolen all of his pictures behind him. Maybe that's some newfangled decorating technique I'm unaware of. I don't know. But also, congratulations, Matt. Congratulations on
Thank you.
having your life taken completely away from you. 4 children I have, and I don't regret having any of them. Well, I mean, I didn't have them, Alicia did. But I will say that the amount of time that they take out of my day, it's amazing that I have time to do absolutely anything else. So,
I think that's what
yeah.
scares me the most
That's why I
is
stopped at two.
and probably a wise choice. Like I said, I don't regret having 4 children. But we're not having any more. So.
So Lee, you and I have a lot to talk about. Let's start by doing the thing that I always like to talk to you about, because this is what you and I usually talk about when we meet in person. Which, for those who don't know, Lee does not live very far from me, and this is the first time I have seen Lee's face in maybe a year. So I'm that's not true. I saw you at the summit, so it's been 6 months. We both are pretty busy. But the first thing we should talk about, Lee, is what's going on. And I think you and I were going to talk a bit about the Czech Rain's impact in the mobile forensics world.
Yeah, so for those who are not aware of Czech Rain, it's a new-ish jawbreaking technique, which has come about recently. And basically, it's not fixable. So this isn't something which Apple is going to come around in a few months' time and implement a patch, and then suddenly it stops working. This, at its core, means that this will work pretty much forever. But it is by device. So this will work up through the iPhone 10, but anything past the 10, like the 10S and the 11 and 11 Pro and everything else, currently there's not something equivalent for that. Now, however, think back to a couple of years ago, round about the same time, that there was an interesting case going on where a couple walked into an office party in San Bernardino and shut up the place and killed a bunch of their co-workers. And there were two phones involved in this case, as I recall. One which was open and unlocked, and one which, quite controversially, was an iPhone 5C, which had a PIN code on it. And there was a lot of argument, as you may recall, about this whole PIN code scenario, and a lot of back and forth between government agencies and law enforcement and Apple and privacy advocates and everything else, saying that, you know, law enforcement or government agencies should be provided a backdoor of some description in order to get access to these devices. And, you know, eventually they got access to that phone, and they found there wasn't really anything of any evidential value in there anyway, so it was all completely moot. Now, however, if Check Rain had been available back then, it may have been able to have been of use, because Check Rain doesn't just allow you to get full, unfettered access to the underlying file system, but you can actually use it to get what is referred to as... one second, I didn't close that tab, did I? Known as what's called BFU. And BFU stands for Before First Unlock. Now, for those of you who've done iPhone type forensics before, you'll know that if you turn the phone off, reboot it, or wait for some period of time, that the phone will automatically lock and will ask for you to enter a PIN code again, even if you have Touch ID or Face ID enabled. So what this is allowing you to do now is to get in while this device is in a locked state. So no longer do you have to hang around or go to the person and beat them with a piece of soap in a sock in order to have them turn over their PIN code.
Allegedly.
I've never witnessed it personally. So you don't have to go through any kind of legal or pseudo legal process to get it into that phone now. If you're using Check Rain, which I guess is still kind of like a pseudo legal process, you could actually get into that device and gain a bunch of artifacts and intelligence gathering information from that device just before, even if the device is completely locked. So it's interesting seeing the adoption of this, because it, like, Mattia has done a great job of documenting a lot of the stuff which can be done with this. And now you're starting to see people like Elcomsoft add this, add Check Rain into their processes, so that, you know, you use Elcomsoft and you plug in a phone and you set Check Rain going, and it does the before first unlock dump of that device.
Which I know from Heather's screenshots on Twitter, it looks like Cellebrite's about to add the same.
Yeah, and so I just think it's fantastic. You know, I mean, we've had all this going on for so long, and, you know, the whole question of privacy is like a massive issue for people. Like, no one wants, you know, the government or police or anything else, you know, for whatever reason, to have access to our data. Well, I mean, of course not. I mean, the problem is that we still need to balance that with the ability to prosecute people for bad things that they've done. And whenever we have exploits like this, now I'm not saying that this is something which everyone in the world should have access to, but it's a race. It's always a race. It's something is secure, and then it gets broken. Something is secure, then it gets broken. Something's secure, and it gets broken. And, you know, eventually, you know, stuff like this will fall off everyone's radar, and then there'll be something else in a few years' time. But I just think it's really interesting. And it's, if you aren't aware of this and you haven't seen any of the research done on it, I'd definitely go and check out Mattia's blog, which is blog.digital-forensics.it. And he's got a bunch of really good stuff on there about, you know, whether this will bypass USB restricted mode, whether you can get a full, basically forensic image of the device, and so on. You know, what devices are compatible, what iOSs are compatible, and so on. So definitely well worth going and checking that out.
I agree. And we're doing some testing and playing with it as well. It's really neat. And maybe this is something that leads to our next topic that someone might present at the DFIR Summit, which my understanding is the call for presentations and early registrations open tomorrow.
That's also my belief, and I will be submitting a presentation, not on CheckRain, but on something else. The summit is going to be July 16th and 17th this year for the actual two-day summit, and then classes will be the week following. Just found out today I'll be teaching Forensics 500 at the summit this year.
Congratulations, Lee. That's awesome.
I'm very excited for that. And also somewhat nervous. So that's going to be fun. It's also going to be a lot cheaper this year than it has been in the past.
Yes.
And this is an intern.
The summit, not the courses.
The summit, yes. I don't want to be on the hook for that. So the two-day summit itself, I think it used to be like $1,300 or something. Yep. to attend. There's been a lot of internal discussion at SANS, and a lot of back and forth, and finally we've got it to the point where we can say the admission price now is $275.
Yes.
And it's a complete and utter bargain, right? If you go onto YouTube and you see all of the previous presentations that we've got uploaded there, for the SANS Forensic Summit, you'll see some absolutely amazing presentations. Now, every year, you know, I've been going to this for the last, this will be year 12. This will be the 12th one in a row that I've attended. And every year when I've gone, there's always been, you know, three or four presentations that I've immediately been able to go back to work and use what I learned in those presentations to further my own casework and everything else. Seriously, we have some of the best people in the field showing up to give presentations. And last year, it was the first time that I had the ability to help with the selection process for these presentations. And the ones which we actually had to say no to, there were some really good ones in there that I would really like to have seen, but we only have like a limited number of spaces for those presentations, unfortunately. So you know that the presentations which are given are the best which have been submitted.
Yes. Now, the good news is apparently we're going to be expanding the space. I understand there's going to be some more activities, more rooms. They're not willing to say exactly what they're going to do with all the space just yet. So I'm also waiting to find out what it's going to be. But what's interesting to me is that there's a chance, because you know the summit has always done well. There's always a large amount of people at the summit. But with the price now, I wouldn't be surprised if this is the first time the summit sells out. And that's something that you should be aware of and thinking of. If you're thinking about going to the summit this year, this July in Austin, you might want to consider moving up your priority on getting the summit ticket, even if you're not sure about taking the class or you're thinking your class gets approved later. At $275, you can probably get reimbursed for that or something pretty easily. I would not be at all surprised if this sells out fairly quickly. And the reason I say that is, if you think about the landscape of conferences that are left, there are far less than there used to be. And the one that has consistently been having some of the best content, some of the newest research, and some of the things that create the largest amount of discussion afterwards has been the summit. So the fact that it's $275 now, I mean, I didn't go for years because of the cost, and then I got to go for free when I could speak, but that's a really good deal. And so I'm looking forward to seeing what it's going to become because of that. I mean, Lee, you and I know, for years and years, it was CIC. That was the biggest forensics conference you had to go to because everyone was there, all the vendors were there, all the stuff was there. And then we went to the summit for the technical content. If this lower cost threshold allows the summit to become that larger event, it's not inconceivable.
Yeah, it'll be interesting because I don't know exactly what the plans are. The summit's always been somewhat of a more cozier type of atmosphere. So I don't know if we'll ever get to the point where it's like this huge ordeal. But because we're hosting it in the same place as we have been for the last few years, there is going to be limited space this year, especially at this price point. And so, I mean,
we're not talking ShmooCon. It's not going to disappear in 5 seconds.
Probably not. But, I mean, we also have a lot of people who come on a regular basis.
Yes.
And so those people especially, they will be the first people to buy tickets, for sure. Like, I already saw Brian Moran comment here. Mm-hmm. And Brian Moran probably has already got his credit card out and is waiting till the stroke of midnight or whenever it is the tickets become available.
That is incorrect. So Brian Moran will be speaking. Like Brian Moran always speaks. And then he will go for free and bring some for free. And which is the greatest benefit of speaking in the DFR Summit is not only do you get to go for free, but you also get to have someone come with you as a guest pass for free, which is a nice speaker benefit.
That's also true, yes. Oh, I hope he does speak. That'd be awesome. But yeah, so that brings up the other thing, right? Is that yes, the price is only $275, so basically means it's a lot more accessible and everything to everyone. And you have more money for hotel and going out on Sixth Street and drinking copious amounts of alcohol and so on. In addition to that, like you just said, you can also submit a presentation for tomorrow, or sign tomorrow, and it could be anything.
Tuesday.
Is it Tuesday? Oh, sorry. Oh, yeah, tomorrow's Saturday. Yeah, I thought you said tomorrow earlier on. You confused me. So whenever you submit, it can be any topic to do with digital forensics whatsoever. Like last year, we had a talk on pipeline forensics.
Yeah, that was really good.
Yeah, and going into that, I'm like, what's pipeline forensics? Is it like, I start here and I move through the process until I get here? No, it's actually physical oil pipelines on oil rigs and everything else. And it was like, this is incredible. This is a great thing to learn. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, anything you can think of, if you have some research you've been thinking, I've been waiting for the right time to present this to everyone, I would strongly urge you to do it at the summit. It's just a great environment with amazing people who are going to be receptive and ask you good, intelligent questions. And if you go back and look on YouTube, you'll see the professional quality of some of these presentations and the way that they're recorded and presented to people. And it's a big deal. And you also get like a really cool coin from Sands showing that you've been a presenter there.
That's true. In addition, one of the things that people may not know, and I don't think we make a big deal as an RFP process, but it is a big deal, is that if you are selected to speak, we will assign you a mentor. And that means that one of the advisory committee who helps select the speeches will actually be, usually we pick ourselves who we think we could best help. But we'll review your presentations with you. We'll give you feedback on what you're doing. We'll help you craft things. We'll help you figure stuff out. Well, you should have stuff figured out. But we'll help you figure out whether or not things are working or you know, if this is, if any information is repetitive or new or anything like that. So you actually have a support structure there for you as well through the process after you're selected before you present to help you, you know, do as well as you possibly can. And I've enjoyed being able to help others and I think I helped. So you have to ask them if my mentor, if I would even call it mentoring, if me telling them to put less slides and more pictures was as helpful as it could have been. But Lee, there's something else that happens at the summit that will be opening up soon.
There is
something that involves paperclips.
No, it doesn't. No. It doesn't. It really doesn't. All right. Yes. So we have the Forensic Forecast Awards as part of the SANS Forensic Summit or DFIR Summit each year. And, you know, a couple of months ago, I got a little bit concerned because my brother's wedding date back in England was going to collide with the Forensic Summit. So I was asking if someone else could present the awards in my stead. However, my brother has decided to see the light on such things and has changed his wedding date. and so I will be now at the summit to present the awards. And no, I was not presenting the Golden Globes the other day, just in case anyone is wondering. That is not me. There's a big difference between me and Ricky Gervais. Okay? He has a beard. So,
I should hope, though, if you were to ever have a last time doing the nominations, that you would go out like he did.
I wouldn't wait until I was on my way out to do stuff like that. You know. anyway. When the nominations open for that is a good question. I wanted to get them open a lot earlier this year, but I was waiting on a lot of feedback from people. The idea going forward is that here's my plan this year, is that next Friday, I leave for a week. I'm going to Tokyo to teach a class for SANS. Once I get back, I'm going to open the nominations for the 2020 Forensic Forecast Awards. That will be for any work conducted in 2019. Okay, so all those people who wanted to vote for CAPE last year and couldn't, now is your year to do it. Then, almost simultaneously, I'm going to open the nominations for the 2021 Forensic Forecast Awards. Because as I've spoken to people, one of the things which we've found is that people don't remember what happened in 2019, even though it was only like a month ago. Oh, wait, 10 days ago, right? They don't remember. And so what they want to be able to do is place nominations for things as soon as they happen. So a good blog post comes out, they can do a nomination. A good piece of software is written by someone, they want to post that nomination immediately. So we're going to do that side by side. So just bear in mind that 2021 will be for everything going on this year. 2020 will be for everything going on last year. And then there's going to be maybe a couple of other things too. There's one thing specifically I've wanted to do for a very long time and just never had the means or opportunity to do it, which is the Forensic Forecast Hall of Fame. And so here we'll probably recognize a couple of individuals or organizations that have done an exceptional job. Dave, you and I are going to have a serious...
I'm very pleased with myself right now.
And we'll be recognizing them, and they'll be inducted into the Hall of Fame. And what will likely happen is that that will mean that they are... it will also mean that they are held in high regard by the community, and they probably will not be either nominated or voted for in future Forensic Forecast Awards, just because we don't want it to become very samey, where the same, you know, the same people win the same award year after year after year. It just it gets to be... it's not boring, because, I mean, I'm hosting it, it's never boring. We don't want it just to be repetitive. And so that's my idea for this year, and we'll see how that goes and how well that's received. But like I said, that's something which I want to put in there. And I'm undecided right now whether that's going to be like a ring, like you get, like if you get into like the WWE Hall of Fame, or if it's going to be like a coin that you would get whenever you do something else exceptional. I'm still working on the details for that. But that's my plan for this year.
Very nice.
And like always, if people have got suggestions on what to do, you know, new categories or whatever else, I'm always open to those.
I just want to point out that by your own rules, if Clippy was introduced to the Hall of Fame, then he could never be voted for again.
Yeah. No. And there's certain people, and they know who they are, who just their pure association with Clippy may never get, and may never be viable for a Forensic Forecast Award either. Stephen Fisher Davis, you are definitely on that list.
There's one more. We have a couple minutes left, and there's one more summit left that I think we should talk about, and that is the cloud summit. So there will be a SANS cloud security summit. It is no longer a secret that myself and Pierre Ledome are working on Forensics 509, the enterprise cloud forensics incident response class. And so they've gotten us involved. We're now part of the advisory board. It will be in Frisco, Texas, May 27th through June 2nd. That'll be the summit and then classes. It's right now just the cloud security classes. I can guarantee the cloud forensics class will not be done by then or in beta. I know that for a fact because we're writing it right now and it's going to take a while. But the CFP is currently open. So if you have a topic, not just on cloud security, but cloud forensics, cloud IR, cloud IR preparedness, all those kind of things. Right now, the CFP is open. It's in Frisco, which is very close to me. So I'm very happy about that. And there's going to be a lot of cool stuff going on. So if you are at all interested in the cloud, and if you're not, you should be, based upon all the stuff that we're doing now, I hope to see you there. So that's it. We're coming up on the top of the hour. From all of us, thank you very much for tuning in. We really do appreciate it. I know that I need to get better about putting out a schedule. I'm starting to calm down a bit, start getting things back to a bit almost normal order. But there's still other interesting changes happening that I'll talk about in the future. But things are good. Things are good. Thanks for watching. Thanks for joining. For those watching things recorded, I do get a little alert when I check it. For the new comments. So if I see something and it's a question, I'll make sure to respond to it. For those who are trying to send me messages or notifications on Twitter, if I seem less responsive in the last couple months, it's because I uninstalled Twitter from my phone because I realized that I was spending too much of my day going, what's that? And so I now just check it like once or twice a day. So The easiest way to then get in contact with me would be leave a comment or send me an email. And lastly, for those who don't know, Matt and I are at KPMG, and we are hiring and looking for more people to join the fun. We do a lot of interesting work, so if that's something you're interested in, please let us know. Andrew Rathbert says, idea for the Forecast Hall of Fame, maybe a badge on a claim, just like a GAC badge in addition to a physical coin. That would be interesting. Wrestling belts have been thrown out, Lee. I was thinking the a recreation of the Medal of Honor from the ending scene of A New Hope. So, we'll see. Thank you, everyone. And we will see you next time.